Welcome to part 11 of the lecture on designing organic syntheses. Today we will discuss two examples of some more complex target molecules and of course again stereoselectivity will be of importance. So the first target structure is this one. It is the so-called prelock Gerasi lactone. And it is a benchmark target molecule for newly developed methods for stereoselective synthesis. So it is not too hard to find these bonds. We can see as crucial bonds within the retrosynthetic analysis. So please try some steps into the retrosynthetic analysis with this target molecule. Most of you realized that this CO bond is the crucial strategic bond we should target upon first. Well, okay. We disconnect this strategic bond. We have donator reactivity at the oxygen, need acceptor reactivity here. Okay, we could add a leaving group X at that position, but this would not represent a significant simplification. An acceptor reactivity in better position of a carbonyl group, well, is easy achieved if we assume that we have an alpha beta unsaturated carbonyl group there. Okay, so and now the alpha beta unsaturation and we will get to this structure. This is much simpler as the one before, since here we have only two chiral centers. Well, we have more stereo information in there because we have a double bond and there are cis and trans isomers, of course. So if we treat that under the right reaction conditions, this will act as a nucleophile here and hopefully will selectively give that product. The problem is now, of course, we should think about, would this cyclization lead to this product? Presumably yes, because this, well, it's not directly a natural product, but it derives from natural products. And we can assume that if nature produces that, this structure has an advantage compared to other isomers. But with your knowledge in organic chemistry, you can prove that. So let's have a closer look at this structure. And therefore, we should write it down as a six-membered ring, then in the chair conformation, and then we will notice that for this structure all substituents, the two muffle substituents and the bigger one here, are in equatorial position. And this is, of course, thermodynamically preferred. And indeed, in the thermodynamic equilibrium, we have this structure with a selectivity of 4:1 concerning its C2 epimere. This, all the other three stereogenic centers are highly selective, almost 100%. Here, 4:1. Okay, it's the preferred one. So, and since this reaction, of course, should be in equilibrium with lying on that side of the equilibrium, then it can react back and forth, and as the equilibrium, then finally we will have that one, and a small part of that might be present. So, this is no problem, therefore. Then we could go on. Double bonds are strategic bonds. Some kind of aldol condensation. Well, you have to protect that one, and we have to protect this one, and with an ester enolate, and here the aldehyde, yes, somehow we will make that. So we get the simplification to this structure, acid and an aldehyde functionality. In this case, we might already have present the cyclic hemiacetal . This makes clear that we will get to this hemiacetal by selectively reducing this cyclic acid anhydride with maybe a chiral complex hydride would be an idea. Reduction with an chiral reducing agent. So, this should be enough with that structure. Here, one would have a look in SciFinder, of course. This is small enough that we have good chances that others have already worked out a nice protocol for synthesizing this molecule. Let's go to another interesting target. a sesquiterpenoid. Its name is aromadendrin. The first step in retrosynthetic analysis is fairly easy. Where is the most sensitive functional group? Well, actually, it's not the cyclopropane unit, but the exocyclic double bond. One has to be careful with that, because under somewhat acidic conditions, it will presumably isomerize in. Therefore, it's a good idea to transform that into the corresponding ketone. Since the corresponding Wittig reaction shouldn't be a problem. So, now for this target, new target structure, we should summarize some preliminary considerations. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 stereogenic centers. All are adjacent . Therefore, we don't need some step of remote induction or introduce chiral information twice into our synthesis. Maybe it's okay if we start from a compound from the chiral pool with just one stereogenic center, and this is then the stereogenic control element for all the other centers generated within our synthesis. So, we have this, well, not unusual combination of a 7 and a 5 membered ring. You know these 7 and 5 membered ring combination from the natural product azulene. That isomer of naphthalene. Well, but setting up that as a saturated system, well, you need therefore a good idea. And this idea could, for instance, be if we have a 7 and a 5 membered ring. So 5 plus 7 membered might derive from the combination of 2 6 membered ring. From 2 six-membered rings. Of course, annihilated six-membered rings. So that means we have two annihilated six-membered rings, and we have a rearrangement, enlarging one of those rings, making the other one smaller. That's what we could look for. In addition, we have a ketone directly alpha to the annihilation position, and we have seen situations like that. Maybe you remember from organic chemistry 2 that pinacol-pinacolone rearrangement two five-membered rings by enlargement gave a six-membered and a five-membered spirofused. Now one should think about, well, this situation, we have two six-membered rings and want to achieve the transformation to seven and five-membered, enlarging this one and making that one smaller. How could we achieve that? We need a leaving group here. Well, let me put on first a diol, a pinacol. The pinacol-pinacolone rearrangement in that case wouldn't work, since by protonation we would get the rather stable carbocation, the tertiary carbocation. We need that as a leaving group, somehow generating a cation at this position, and then that rearrangement would occur. I think this is an interesting motif we could work with while designing the synthesis of that target. C, another consideration. What about the construction of the cyclopropane unit? Well, we could think about having an olefin and the cyclopropanation with a corresponding carbene. So, how about this one? Unfortunately, the reaction to this won't work. Why? I think you already should know. The CH insertion is an ultra-fast reaction, and this carbene will transfer to this propene immediately. So that doesn't work. Well, maybe One could think about cyclopropanation with dichlorocarbene and then exchange those chloride against methyl groups. Well, this is not that easy. Maybe here with a question mark. It's the same oxidation state, and there are reactions known. We talked about that in the lecture about stoichiometric organometallics, connection with tetrabrachians, and so on. You can transform a carbonyl group into a dimethylmethylene unit. But again, question marks. So, however, one could keep in mind that you can set up a three-membered ring having a nucleophilic reactivity here and an acceptor reactivity there, that means a leaving group. Another motive for taking that into consideration for targeting this aroma dendrine. So, now D. We already noticed that we have five adjacent stereogenic centers. That led us to the idea, let's look for a chiral starting material from the chiral pool. So, and here we have such a structure, this aldehyde. This is a terpenoid called pyrrole aldehyde. Might be interesting to know that the corresponding oxime name is pyrrolatine. This is 2,000 times more sweet than sugar and is applied as a sweetener mainly in Japan. So, in pyrrolaldehyde, we have here that chiral center, and we have those three carbons here. Maybe it's possible to construct a three-membered ring. Well, and indeed, that has been done. So again, let's draw the structure of pyrrolaldehyde. First step, hydrogen bromide addition, Markovnikov addition to that double bond, and acetic acid as the solvent. Leads to this tertiary bromide. And now, the most acidic position is this one. you get that conjugated eno. And an intramolecular substitution will lead to this structure with that dimethyl cyclopropane moiety. Let's call that A. And now we have to think about how do we get from A to that ketone, making use of the idea of a pinacol-pinacolone rearrangement. So this now is a bidirectional analysis. Well, please have a try. So let's draw once again that ketone which we are targeting for. So, once again, we would like to bring this structure and that one somehow together. Okay. And we would like to try the idea to apply a pinacol-pinacolone rearrangement for the construction of that adjacent or annulated 7- and 5-membered ring. And therefore, we have to think about a retro-pinacol-pinacolone rearrangement in our retrosynthetic analysis. So, and, well, 6-membered ring, 6-membered ring. Here, the OH group, we don't care about the stereochemistry at this and that center. Here, the leaving group X, whatever that is, we could think about that later on. Then, sorry, here is the CH3 group. Well, the stereochemistry here should be also rather clear. All those will be preferentially on the same side as the others here, the other substituents. So, some of you thought about this bond as strategic bond. Yes, it is not wrong. However, it doesn't lead to a simplification in the next step, but, well, assuming that we can add the OH group and that X to these two positions, maybe simultaneously, but this addition to an olefin, that would lead to a much simplified structure, intermediary structure. So, what do we have here? A cyclohexene moiety, the retron of a Diels-Alder reaction. A Diels-Alder reaction doesn't work well if we take propene as the olefin. Should be much better if we have, well, an electron deficient dienophile. So let's change the oxidation state of that CH3 group, put in a carbonyl group there. So, retro Diels-Alder within our retrosynthetic analysis. Acrylic aldehyde as the dienophile. The Diels-Alder reaction will proceed somewhat stereoselectively. And now, getting from here to there is rather straightforward, since, again, Wittig reaction could provide that olefin. So, let's have a look at the real synthesis that then has been performed based on this retrosynthetic analysis. So, as I told you, these steps work quite nicely. Well, the overall yield of this aldehyde with the cyclopropane moiety was 41%. Well, that's not excellent, but it is through several steps with a relatively cheap starting material, and it is the beginning of your synthetic procedure. The next step, Wittig reaction to this structure, worked with almost quantitative yield, 98%. Now things became a bit more complicated. The Diels-Alder reaction was performed at 100 degrees. So the 100 degrees are not necessary for the Diels-Alder reaction to occur, but should help that more selectively the exo Diels-Alder product is formed. With the endo Diels-Alder product, we have the wrong stereochemistry at this center. So, even though the reaction was performed at 100 degrees, not the thermodynamically favored product was the predominant, but the kinetically favored product in an 15% to 15% yield of this one, 75% yield of this was obtained, and a couple of byproducts. So they can be separated, and well, this one was then treated with a base or a base similar to potassium t-butoxide, just 5 minutes at 20 degrees. Then it is deprotonated and protonated again under equilibrium conditions at this position with the most acidic proton, which will lead to an epimerization here, favoring the exo-Diels-Alder product. So in equilibrium, we have the ratio of endo to exo 17:83. And the one with the 83, that is the thermodynamically favored one we are in need of. Okay? So then reduction, they reduced that with lithium aluminum hydride. You got the tertiary alcohol. They transformed it into a leaving group there, and then treated a tosylate or so, and then treated again with a complex hydride for the complete reduction to the CH3 group. While this is an alder synthesis in Jacks, I think from the late 60s. Meanwhile, there are better, straightforward methods for directly getting the reduction done from here to there, not with three steps. Nevertheless, these three steps were performed with almost quantitative yield. And they are here. Okay, so next step. Osmium tetroxide oxidation, we get the diol. The diol was obtained with 84% yield. The problem now is, if you have the OH group here, as I told you, this is the better leaving group. We have to transform that selectively into a leaving group, well, with a tosylation. So first, osmium tetroxide. Secondly, a tosylation. Transform that into a tosyl group. And this is selectively possible, of course, with a secondary alcohol, because the tertiary alcohol is sterically more hindered, of course. So, and if you have this tosylate there, the next step, again, is, works very well, better 80% yield, either adding strong base, for instance, potassium t-butoxide, or just with a chromatography through aluminum oxide. which activates the leaving group. That's it. And then we are here, and the final step was a Wittig reaction, which worked with 79%. Well, okay, tomorrow we will go on with synthesis construction of heterocycles, starting with three-membered heterocycles and then going on to four-membered, five-membered, six-membered, and so on. Thanks for listening. See you tomorrow.